Our next guest, please, I would like to say that one of the important ladies would introduce her, but I decided to steal one moment from her because I had the opportunity to work side by side with the Minister of Justice that was previously the Minister of Justice, the Minister of Minister of Foreign Affairs, etc., etc., during the Annapolis negotiations, which were very intense. Do you know how many rounds of meetings we have? People don't believe that we had 360 meetings in this round of negotiations. I would like to say something that is very important. I took the opportunity of being here at the podium in order to say that there is something that is really essential to make progress in the negotiations. First of all, the trust that she had in the on the Palestinian side, creating mutual respect and faith is very important for negotiations. The second point is international evaluation or appreciation, rather. I saw some of the meetings which Tzipi had with leaders of the world, and she really reported on her efforts to reach an agreement, and it put her in another place. And the third statement that is not less important is the faith, the belief that you can reach an agreement and that it is important to do so. Please, Marsha, would you introduce Tzipi?
Hi. I'm going to speak in English, although I probably could speak in Hebrew, but not as beautifully as you just did, so I think I will turn to English. I'm very lucky that I get to introduce Tzipi Livni, who, of course, needs no introduction. We're all very excited and proud that she has decided to take on the Justice Ministry in this administration. And I think justice is probably the perfect place for Tzipi because she is best known for her integrity that she maintains no matter what, and also her courage to have changed her mind and to have learned the importance of moving forward with the two-state solution. So I don't know that I have to go through your entire resume. I'm pretty sure everybody here knows it. We're excited to have you with us here tonight and to help to show us what you think is the way forward in this administration. Thank you.
Hello and good evening to you all. First of all, I would like to thank you, Udi and Marsha, for this nice introduction, but especially Udi. It's so complicated to restart this whole process anew, but I haven't lost even one gram of faith. And now we have to recreate the confidence. I have heard the headlines from this conference, and most of them deal with the threats around the state of Israel and, of course, things that are part and parcel of our everyday life, and the Hezbollah and Iran that wants to keep on nuclearization, and the Hamas in Gaza and Egypt that stands on the brink of a very harsh economic crisis, and nobody knows where the politics is going to take her. Jordan that is flooded by refugees, and we can add to it more elements that relate to the reality in the area. And this is a hot, bubbling, and stormy reality. And we see civil wars and a leader that slaughters his people and radical Islamic groups that become more and more powerful. But once we hear all that, it is true that that experts have to give those evaluations of the situation. But our task in the Israeli government is to make the decisions and not only to evaluate a situation. And we are committed in our decisions, but when we hear everything that is going on around us, the immediate feeling, which is justified, of each and every one of the people who listen to or who opens, turns on the television, everybody feels that this is a tough neighborhood, and people have said that they've called it a villa in the jungle, but I would like to contradict it and to bring back the and to contradict this conception of a villa in the jungle, which I disagree with for a number of reasons. First of all, the word villa has some sort of wealth, and for some of the citizens in the state of Israel, the state of Israel is a rented out apartment, not a villa. When I look at the population in Israel, it's more of a condominium where everybody lives in an apartment of their own, with their own beliefs, sometimes with their own language, and in the best case we meet on the staircase. But I especially disagree with this definition of a jungle, in of a villa in the jungle, because it gives us the feeling that everybody around, everything around us is in a jungle, and we have to rest on an armchair in the villa, and the other things don't relate to us. They happen in the jungle. And you're mistaken. You're strategically mistaken if you think so. First of all, whatever is happening outside projects to us, and we have to make the decisions according to what we think is happening here. But not only that, what's the significance of what is happening outside on the decisions that we are supposed to make? And according to my view, the time that elapses doesn't do good to those who believe that the principle of two nation states serves its interests. It's true for those in Israel that believe that two nation states are the interest of Israel, and those on the Palestinian side that think likewise. And the more we have the opportunity within this turmoil to get to an agreement, and I'll speak about that, the sooner the better, especially because we don't know what's going to happen later on, and if we will really be able to find both support and a partner for this agreement. And the second thing that we have to understand about this villa and jungle thing is that the Israeli-Palestinian conflict is not something that happens outside. It happens inside. And if in the past the slogan of the settlement was Judea and Samaria is here, today I can tell the representatives of the settlers in the Israeli government, Judea and Samaria is here, friend. And this is why the decision about what's going to happen to them is not, it does not have only to do with the people who live there in the settlements, not all only related to the future of the settlers, but to the future of each and everybody of us. That is why we are the ones that should make this decision, because it relates to the future of us all. Because as long as there is a conflict, it affects our values, our life, the legitimacy of the state of Israel, its international status, our ability to live as we should live as part of the advanced Western world according to our true values. It projects also on the legitimacy of military operations when they are needed, and fortunately they are needed. And that is why we have to understand that the conception of the conflict or the need to get to an arrangement is part and parcel of our national security. Beyond that, the fact that it affects on the economy and our life and the racism that starts to gnaw away in us, in our midst, and we have to deal with it as well. That is why this is our national mission. You can't shut the windows of the villa. We can't close our eyes, at least us, the decision makers can do it. The conflict is not going to disappear on its own. Whoever believes that the wars around us are going to take away the attention of other countries and to do a different attempts without paying attention and without deciding about the political side, all those people who think likewise are simply, maybe they are just on a short term basis, but they they are hugely mistaken on a long-term basis. This is the wrong strategic conception, and we have to make our decisions on a long-term basis. And first of all, we have to change our diskette, so to speak, because some of our frustration in the elections campaign and later is this conception that everything is going to be all right and you don't have to initiate things. And since the time that elapses only weakens us, because the Palestinians get recognized in the UN and in different international organizations, I would want every Israeli to ask to ask himself or herself not how to be suckers with the concessions. We have to deeply understand that what we are going to get is recognized borders in a state which has international legitimacy, and the most important thing is, of course, our ability to maintain the state of Israel as a Jewish and democratic state without any overriding of one of its values and without having to select one of them. I want both, if both a state that would be a national home for the Jewish nation and a democratic state. And when this happens, we'll have a legitimacy against terrorism and against radical organizations. And don't think that we are going to live happily ever after. That's not going to be happen, but on our way to peace we have to go through an arrangement, and that is why a settlement, and that is why this is not just a dream of a bleeding heart. So that is also okay, by the way, but this is part and parcel of the security conception of the state of Israel. A security conception for me in the new age of missiles and technological developments is not necessarily the terrain conception, the terrain based conception, or the territory-based conception. And I know that some people say, okay, we left Gaza and Lebanon and we got what we got. I would like to remind you that we left Lebanon after we have maintained the territory for many, many years, and we decided militarily to withdraw from Lebanon. That is why the security conception should be different, and an arrangement or settlement is part and parcel of this conception. But if you are rational, you can't just throw a key to the other side of the border and hope that somebody is going to catch the key if they want to get to a settlement. We can't afford that. And that is why the goal, the critical role of the United States does not only relate to the security conception of the state of Israel, but also to give us a feeling of true safety and security here in the state of Israel before, during, and after getting into negotiations, in order for us to know that even if we take risks, and every settlement and arrangement has risks, and this is the best option, better than a situation without a settlement. It is very important for those settlements or arrangements to be realistic and such that would enable us to make progress in the around the negotiation table. And that is why it's precisely the activities of John Kerry, the Secretary of State, is critical. I think that we should congratulate him for this determination and readiness by the Americans to be involved, and I would like to congratulate him for his determination and his wish to restart the process, as long as we are doing it in a way in which the process is going to represent the basic interests of the State of Israel, most of which are also the interests of the United States. And that is why during with a due process we would be able to act without a collision. So this is probably a type of an opportunity to restart the process after their election with a new government in Israel, despite the fact that the coalition is composed of people who think the opposite, or people who are involved in other topics and do not see the need for this process and the end of and final settlement. As I've said, faith is important, but it's not enough. It's a prerequisite, but it's not sufficient. And the reality is that there have been 4 years of moratorium, of freezing with a total distrust, and we have to create a process of negotiation which would be really which would be real and not blaming each other. A faith or belief that the other side wants to get to a settlement while keeping our interests, and sometimes it's very difficult and complex, and we had many disagreements in the room, and out we could say there's no partner, etc., but we made an effort to try to bypass the obstacles and to keep on moving ahead. And according to my conception, and I am here, I am in this government out of this faith in the international conception that says that first of all we should be partners, but also should check if Israel can be taken out from the political moratorium. I have arguments against the Palestinians as well, and 5 years ago, in fact, when we got into the negotiation, there was this will, this desire. I don't know if you know, but Annapolis was quite a short process with the idea to put an end to the conflict, with the commitment to have to maintain the roadmap without getting into detail. Now I know that many say that there is no partner on the other side. Do you know that there are people who even hope that there's not going to be any partner, because then there are going to be no allegations against us? And if people arrive to that conclusion, maybe for it's a good situation for the ones who are against the settlement. But that's not what I think. I think that we have to restart such a process. It's true that in the past we had those days on which there was a leader on the other side that did not want to get to an arrangement, but he could deliver, he could enforce it in times of need on his people. And there are instances in which there is leadership on the other side that wants to reach a settlement on the basis of two states, but has no influence on the population. Today we've got both. We've got Gaza, which is dominated by the Hamas, a terrorist organization, a radical organization which is against the quartet conditions to recognize Israelis and recognize previous agreements. We can't hope to get peace with Hamas, and they are not a potential partner for such a settlement. And we have Abu Mazen that can't put his foot in Gaza, and in Judea and Samaria we are still there on site. So it depends, but it depends also on our activities over there. And the mission on our agenda today is how to restart this process, how to make progress in the without blowing it up every now and then, and how to really reach a settlement or a settlement. So first of all, I would like to answer some just questions. First of all, whom are we negotiating with? So I think that it should the negotiations should be conducted with Abu Mazen. He's the official representative of the Palestinians. He should sign, even if it's a signatory on an empty bank account. He is still the signatory, and we still prefer a settlement over unilateral actions. And the Hamas should remain outside this process unless it accepts the quartet terms. And we have the possibility to recruit the world around this concept. In the United States, it's taken for granted for them as well, but also to those European countries and the Turks as well, that there is a zero-sum game, not between Israel and the Palestinians, but rather within the Palestinian politics. Whoever strengthens the Hamas or Gaza, it's not something that is done against Israel. It is detrimental, first of all, to the capabilities of Abu Mazen, to the capability of Abu Mazen to get to a settlement. So strengthening the Hamas equals reducing the ability to get to a settlement. The second question is, what about? What are we going to negotiate? I think that we have to speak about the core issues in order to get to a solution that would put an end to the conflict. I know that there are those who think that interim arrangements is something extraordinary, and some people think that you can reach a final settlement. Others still think that it's too big decisions to make simultaneously. But I believe that we have to get into the around the negotiation table in order to present the goal, which is the end of the conflict, for two reasons. First of all, our own interest in the state of Israel to end the national claims of the Palestinians from us, and we can answer it only if we answer all the core issues. And we also have to say that once you start to delineate a border, it gets to Jerusalem as well, and we also want to know what's going to happen on the other side of the border, not only the fact that there is a border. And the other reason, the second reason, is that these declarations are going to give us the fuel. If people are saying, I want now something different to put an end to the conflict on the basis of this principle, it is going to be perceived by the international organizations as someone who really doesn't want to get to a settlement, and the door is going to be shut, and we won't be able to get into the room of the negotiation. So it's not the right thing to declare it or to do it either. It's clear in this room that each one of the parties has its own goals, but we want to put an end to the conflict and to decide about the borders in a form of settlement where most Israelis live, security arrangements which would be suitable to our needs. The Palestinians on their part want this territory that has been the territory that has been defined according to the 1967 borders. They want an answer to the refugees, and not only related to the establishment of a Palestinian state, and I think that such a state would be an answer for them as well. And the question is also about Jerusalem. The two peoples hold on to Jerusalem, and we'll have to discuss that in this in camera conditions. That is why our interest is to put all the core issues on the table, but undoubtedly, if we reach a settlement, the implementation is something that would have to be made in stages. It's not a wedding, and when the bell rings, everything is going to be settled. The agreements or the should be in stages. I am not in favor of dates. I'm in favor of implementation. It should say what should be done. I would always, in this case, I hope that the terms would be such that have to take place in reality, not only and not just dates. We have to think about something that is on in the room, and nobody speaks about it, and this is Gaza. Gaza, in fact, is under the Hamas domination, and Abu Mazen can't affect whatever is going on there. And that is why we have to make it clear that if, as part the Palestinian conception that speaks about a holistic state that includes both the Judea and Samaria and Gaza, since I'm talking about implementation, it should be it should happen there. And once all the security arrangements are set, and the government should be effective not only against terrorism but also not composed of terrorists themselves, and we should not try to throw the key to the other side. There are so many changes and upheavals in the Arab world, and it's much more complex now. You have difficulties in getting the phone number of the Arab League because nobody knows what it is anymore. But their position is critical because there's no Palestinian leader that can reach a settlement with the State of Israel without being supported by the Arab world, and the situation has changed. It's different from Mubarak's Egypt and Morsi's Egypt, and in Jordan the same. But the interests of the Arab world have remained the same. I'm supposed to meet with a delegation from the Arab world that arrives at Washington, and I hope that at least the Arab initiative is going to stay on the table, and maybe they're going to revive it while remembering that it's not a take it or leave it situation. This is it, and now Israel has to accept it or reject it. But there is a position that says that Israel is going to negotiate with the Palestinians, and the Arab world is going to support it during the process and also when the results are known. We are still being asked how this is going to be restarted, and I think that any balanced formula is the right one. In the past, there was no need for formulas. We simply created the process, but the initiative had been Israeli. We got into the room and started the negotiations. Today, there are serious measures as well, serious tests. I distinguish between steps that have no strategic significance, such as the release of prisoners, but they are confidence-building measures, and Israel can be more benevolent. And the other approach that treats the core issues, where every formula will have to be balanced at the entrance to the room in order to keep to our interests in the room of negotiations as well. And we'll have to agree beforehand how to be involved in this process. It's going to take some time, and how to know to blow up what's happening in the room, but how to cope with different situations such as provocation, and everything should enable us to stay in the room and keep on negotiating despite the external circumstances. I'm still a believer. I believe that this is possible, and of course we must create this opportunity and restart the process. Those who hope that the whole idea is to be convinced that there is no chance, I'm saying that there is no chance for me to think that there is no chance. And I don't believe that public diplomacy is a substitute. If somebody thinks that he can prove that there is no partner and the world is going to respect us, okay, stay wherever you are, but that's not going to happen. And to conclude, as public diplomacy is not a political substitute, I would like to say something as the Minister of Justice. Even the discussion is not a legalistic one, and not about rights on land. And that is why, from the report of the Edmund Levy Committee, that does not make any change, that it can't replace a political decision that we have to make. Of course, it's going to be detrimental on the international arena if we decide to adopt it. But what is important is that in the international arena, there are legal processes that are not in our favor. This is where the Palestinians gain. The declaration in the UN, threats of going to the ICC. Even now, the discussion with the Turks about the need to remove claims vis-a-vis Israeli soldiers and officers. And that's why, if there is no process, the situation is going to be different. And such a process is the interest of the State of Israel. And the one-state solution is also a rejection of Zionism. Without an initiative, there are legal processes that take place, and things are happening, and the positions of Israel are being eroded, and it's not working in our favor. That is why, if Kerry's efforts are going to be fruitful and something reasonable is going to be put on the table of negotiations, what's important is for the international community to do is, because people think that the Palestinians maybe prefer the international attention and not to get into the room, it's important for the Europeans as well to not to let them miss miss another opportunity and that they are not going to be supported in unilateral steps if there is a real opportunity of getting around the negotiation table. This is going to be a test for both parties. I intend to work in order for Israel not to fail in this test, not only to get a good mark from the good uncle from America, but simply because this is our future. Thank you very much.